Hi, welcome to vlog number 83. This is the vlog where I talk about quarterly stories, which is my graphic novel that I hand write, hand letter, hand ink, and then hand to you. Hopefully someday in print. But until that day, it's available serialized online at quarterlystories.com, where you can read it all the way up to page 48. This is the vlog where I document the process and the progress of creating the graphic novel on top of being a full-time father, a full-time art director, and a full-time husband. And it's a very personal story to me about faith and mental illness. And this is gonna be kind of a series of vlogs. So in this first one, I'm just gonna show you how to create a haunted mansion style painting at the very beginning stages, so the first few steps. And that will include gessoing a canvas, or in this case, gessoing MDF board, and then transferring a drawing onto MDF board, and then from that point, doing your underpainting so that you're prepped and ready to make your very own haunted mansion style painting. What I'm using are acrylics, and I'll get into that more in this process video. But yeah, so I hope you guys enjoy this video, and there will be a part two updating shortly after, as I complete the painting. So I'm actually going to try to film the entire process of this painting, so this might be multiple vlogs. But I wanted to just kind of do an in-depth video. The first painting I did, I feel like the lighting wasn't that great, so it didn't really show what I was doing. The second painting, basically, I had to sneak in amid relatives and other people visiting and stuff, so it just wasn't ideal to kind of be able to show you. But these are, I'm gonna show the process that I use to make these family portraits that are like these kind of creepy haunted mansion style paintings. So I'll show you both of them so far. And the idea is that this will be the third in the series. And so that I'll have a nice little triptych that then I can hopefully frame, do something with. And for those of you who might be interested in painting, I paint pretty opaquely and pretty thick, a little boldly, but that's kind of always been my style. So anyhow, if that style kind of interests you, this video might interest you. So generally, I'm starting with what I thought was MDF. In retrospect, I'm not quite sure what kind of board this is, but I got it at Home Depot. I got it cut, and like the entire sheet was like $5. And one cut down to like 8x10, doing kind of a standard size, so it'll be easier to find frames. But it ended up being $5 for about, once I cut these to size, I had Home Depot cut them. And it probably, you know, equates to about 15 canvases of these little 8.5x11, so pretty economical. But I'm painting on board, and what I do before I start my painting so that I end up with a result like this, where you have this kind of clean edge, is to tape off my borders. So you want to use artist tape, which is kind of a good starting point. So anyhow, so I'm gonna tape off my borders. And since this is board and it's pretty durable, if it were illustration board, I'd be careful with how much I'm kind of smoothing that down. But since this is board, I'm gonna go ahead and make sure that's nice and smooth and even. And we'll do the same across the entire board. And then we're gonna gesso this board. And that'll be hopefully part one of this. Hoping to also get the line drawing done, but honestly, there's only so much time in a day. And I've already done some comic book work today, and worked longer than 8 hours as an art director. So it might be a bit much to do more than just this at this point in the video. So here we go. We're basically working on taping off the board. Okay.
nice clean edge. Kind of fold over the corners. Make sure I even out, especially in these little divots, because once you're using wet paint, it will find those spots. And we're ready to start gessoing, so that's how you tape off a board. And hit it with a little bit of gesso. Might be a little too much, but we'll find out. And I'm just using a regular thick kind of brush and acrylic gesso. You can kind of get any brand. This is Liquitex. But I tend to paint on the cheap because I don't paint very often. But I've been pretty stoked about what I can do with like a cheap basic set of acrylics, like the cheapest acrylics you can find basically at an art store. So you want to just do it evenly. In my case, I want this to be pretty thin. Towel and just suck up some of that and then go hit it again to kind of thin out the paint a little bit but make sure it's evenly spread. And then I also want to do a little bit of texture, kind of make it have a little more of a painterly vibe. And that's what I've been doing with all of these. The look I'm going for, a lot of these were painted in oils, and I do paint in oils sometimes, but they're a pain to clean up, and they take forever to dry, and even if you're using a wet-on-wet technique, it's just a lot of setup, and I just frankly chose to do acrylics in light of that, but you can use pretty much anything you want. So there we go. We have our nice gesso, and now I will start this again in about an hour once this gesso has started, or probably tomorrow when I get to actually transferring the drawing. All right, that's how you gesso and tape off a canvas, or a board in this case, and that's the starting point to getting your haunted mansion portrait complete. So for stage two of the painting, what I do is, basically ink my drawing onto the gessoed board. The reason I like ink is because I paint pretty opaquely, and so the ink allows me to A, not be too precious when I'm painting over it, because especially when you're laying out your first darks, they're gonna look kind of surreal. And it helps it show through the painting. So basically, once you have your portrait drawn, you transfer it onto your gessoed board, and then from the gesso board, then you start inking.
Alright, so drawing's complete. Tomorrow I'll come in and try to hit this with darks if I can, and I end up with time. So that's the second part to creating this style of portrait.
Okay, so I'm at the point where I'm gonna do a little bit more, just a little bit of the underwash for my painting. So generally what you're gonna wanna do is start by kind of creating a very dark warm and a dark cool. So I'm just gonna use like this cheap like Liquitex burnt sienna. And it's like student grade, so I'm not using anything special. And then I might use burnt umber too, because that's a really nice deep shade. And the cool thing about cheap paint is you really don't have to worry about like overusing it or anything. And I'm probably gonna use a little bit of this blue. I like still do feel like I'm missing one of my blues. Boom. Okay, phthalo blue. That's what I need. So a little bit of phthalo blue. So most of what I'm gonna be doing right now is just gonna be mixing a little bit of that, and I might end up needing just a little bit of this like alizarin crimson or something crimson. So the gist of this is just to get that initial wash down, and yeah, so we'll see how it goes. But basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to put warm versus cool. I'm thinking that for this I might have like this area kind of with cool colors, so probably highlighting these blues with a little bit of color to kind of contrast it. And then I'm thinking that when I get into the face I might need a little bit more of different colors, so maybe I'll do a full palette. So here's how I set up my palette. I usually do my warms to my cools, and these are basics. These are like the cheapest acrylics on the planet. And you get like a set of primaries for next to nothing. So I said, just gonna get some basics going. Blue I already set up. I've already got kind of my browns. You'll notice I never really use black in my palette. And there's a pretty good reason for that. Because black tends to muddy color. So instead, I'm just going to use the few colors that I have. So that's pretty much my palette. So it's hard to see because I'm using a really dirty palette, but I have like a yellow ochre, yellow, red, green, alizarin crimson, burnt umber, burnt sienna, and then phthalo blue and blue. Phthalo blue is really good for a base, to get these basic parts done. So I think this one's the one that's kind of jinky. One of these is jinky. Maybe not. So for my wash, I might, hey, you know what? I'm not gonna use a thicker brush. Well, no, I will use a thicker brush just to get the general washes. So my first wash, I'm gonna try to get kind of some of this background, which I think is gonna be kind of greenish blue. But I'm gonna want it to be dark because it's spooky. These are the goal of these paintings is to be a little creepy. So I'm mixing that color, and then the idea is just to kind of boldly lay it down a little bit, just to see how's it looking. And I think that might actually be kind of the way to go with this crazy background. Once again, you're not being too precious, just laying down my backgrounds for my background colors. And the gist of an underpainting is that you really want to start laying out some of the shadow work, getting that done. The nice thing about, up until I did those two paintings, I really haven't painted in probably like 5 or 6 years. But the cool thing is I still kind of have my brush chops a little bit because I use brush in my comic quarterly stories all the time. And so using brush pen, I still have a pretty decent control over a brush. Although compared to like friends of mine, maybe not so much, but I'm pretty happy with it. And I like painting, like you'll notice like my ink work is not like super detailed, but it is kind of meticulous a little bit and a little more tight. Whereas my painting style is a little looser and kind of more free. I kind of like being a little more free with my paintings. So here I'm noticing there's a little more blue. So I'm mixing as I go. And just gonna kind of, like once again, this first part always looks really weird. That seems a little too strong, so I'm gonna mix burnt umber to kind of knock it back a little bit. What's interesting is like at this point you literally are just trying to mix. And also you're really just laying the groundwork, so you don't need to be precious. You actually need to be pretty thin and light and not too worried about the results, because at this point you're putting shadows down that you're eventually going to build off of. So once again, I feel like still just a little too much green in this color. So I'm painting fairly thickly because I'm not too worried about getting those little fine edges yet. Actually, I think sometimes using a bigger brush for just like backgrounds isn't a bad move. A little bit more blue in this one. More of that burnt umber. So, like, I still need to knock it back a little bit. There we go. And at this point, by the way, this water in the corner, I just couldn't fit it all on the screen. But just dipping my brush in water. So, what you want to do now at this point is, like I said, kind of start paying attention to some of the color that you might be seeing. So I'm going to continue with this. I think you guys are getting the gist. And what I'm doing is I'm just going to color comparison as I go. So, here we go. It'll be interesting. Kind of fun, but this is step one.
or you're laying out that groundwork for your overpainting. And you want to pay attention to like little contrast and shadow and stuff. Thank you.
part one of the tutorial on how to do a haunted mansion style creepy portrait painting, and I will have part two up once I get to that point in the painting. If you guys enjoyed this, please like, comment, share, and subscribe. Subscribing especially is a really nice way to let me know that you're enjoying the videos. It also gives you updates when these vlogs update as well. Thanks, and I'll look forward to seeing you guys next week.